Concert Band. As you know, today's concert pays a tribute to one of the greatest composers and arrangers of our time, John Williams. And the theme for today's performance, Across the Stars, that could refer to Williams' music from some of his sci-fi blockbusters like Star Wars, or Close Encounters of the Third Kind, or maybe E.T., even Superman. But personally, I like to think that this theme more appropriately refers to the Hollywood stars that have appeared in a multitude of movies, whose music has been scored or arranged by John Williams. Since 1952, Williams has 119 films to his credit, including many of your all-time favorites. Now, don't worry, I'm not going to read them all, but we will show you a list of them on the screen here a little later. Before we get to their music, we want to publicly thank and recognize some great folks for helping make today's concert possible. Special thanks to Ken and Gina Peterson for sponsoring this performance. We truly appreciate the support that they provide for the band. Now, I need your help with a couple things. First of all, if you have not already done so, would you please silence your cell phones? Second, I would ask you to please not use flash photography during the performance. And finally, I ask you to join me in welcoming to the stage the director of the Midland Concert Band, Mr. Joel Wiseman. Now, as usual, we are going to open our concert on a patriotic note. And in keeping with our concert theme, we're going to play for you an arrangement of the Star Spangled Banner by none other than John Williams. And while I'm sure you're going to enjoy hearing it, it is definitely not one to sing along with. Nevertheless, although I'm not asking you to sing today, ladies and gentlemen, to honor America, I invite you to please stand as you are able as the band plays our national anthem.
Thank you.
It's a long and winding road. That opening selection was, of course, the Imperial March, or Darth Vader's theme, one of the most recognized themes from the silver screen that first appeared in the 1980 film, Star Wars: The Empire Strikes Back. Well, our next selection is one of my absolute favorites by John Williams. The Cowboys is a typical example of Williams' capacity to enrich a film story with an almost narrative musical score. And in this arrangement by James Curnow, we are musically transported to the Old West and experience the joys and the hardships of cowboy life. Taken from the 1972 motion picture, The Cowboys, which starred John Wayne and Roscoe Lee Brown, the music complements the story of a 60-year-old Montana cattleman who enlists and ultimately mentors 10 schoolboys as cowboys after the regular ranch hands have all deserted him for the gold rush. The 400-mile cattle drive provides the boys with a different and harsher schooling as they learn the rigors of the job and they have to deal with rustlers. The music conveys the high spirit of wild horses and their taming. There's jollity around the campfire, which contrasts to the loneliness of the open range. The plains have a beauty, though, which is reflected in the song of a lark. The hard work of the cattle drive, including the fording of the wide, muddy river and dealing with many fears and threats, succeeds in maturing the boys into men. Great movie and great music. Now, following the Cowboys, we're going to magically go from 1870s Montana to England in 1991, where we meet 11-year-old Harry Potter, who has just found out about his magical heritage and that he is going to attend Hogwarts School of Witchcraft and Wizardry. Robert W. Smith's setting of John Williams' score to Harry Potter Symphonic Suite, and this music primarily comes from Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone, features six of the film's most memorable themes. The work opens with an introduction of Hedwig, the beautiful owl who delivers the mail to Harry at Hogwarts. Continues with Nimbus 2000, Hogwarts Forever, Quidditch, Leaving Hogwarts, and closes with Harry's Wondrous World. Perhaps our musical theme today is best stated in Chapter 7 of Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone, where Professor Albus Dumbledore says, "Ah, music, a magic beyond all we do here." Back to the music now with the Cowboys, followed by Harry Potter Symphonic Suite. Thank you. You probably are not surprised to hear that Star Wars is one of the highest grossing media franchises of all time. The epic space opera, created by George Lucas, began with the 1977 film Star Wars, which was retroactively titled Episode 4, A New Hope. Star Wars quickly became a worldwide pop culture phenomenon. The original 1977 film was followed by the sequels, Episode 5, The Empire Strikes Back, Episode 6, The Return of the Jedi, and that formed the original Star Wars trilogy that many of us are familiar with. Lucas later returned to the series to write and direct a prequel trilogy, Episode 1, 2, and 3, The Phantom Menace, Attack of the Clones, and Revenge of the Sith. In 2020, George Lucas sold his production company to Disney for a lot of money, relinquishing his ownership of the franchise, and this led to a sequel trilogy consisting of Episode 7, 8, and 9, The Force Awakens, The Last Jedi, and The Rise of Skywalker. The franchise has been further expanded into additional films and other media, including television series, video games, novels, comic books, theme park attractions, a lot, comprising an all-encompassing fictional universe. One constant, though, throughout the 9 major films composing the Skywalker saga is John Williams' wonderful musical scoring. Now, you already heard the Imperial March, Darth Vader's theme, this afternoon. And next on our program, we're going to feature our flute ensemble and a few friends on 2 more Star Wars tunes that I know you're going to enjoy. Here they are with Rey's theme, that's from Episode 7, The Force Awakens, and Cantina Band from Episode 4, A New Hope.
Thank you.
All right, special thanks to Aaron on the drums and Roland on the string bass for accompanying our flutes on that last piece. One of John Williams' 53 Oscar nominations for the Best Original Score was for the 2002 film Catch Me If You Can. Now, that film was directed by Steven Spielberg, and it starred Leonardo DiCaprio and Tom Hanks. The biography follows the life of Frank Abnagel, a con artist and a forger who ended up working for the FBI to help crack the very schemes he had mastered. Williams infused his soundtrack with jazz elements from the mid-1960s when this con artist was at his devious best, and he scored it to reflect the main character's sleuthing, his dysfunctional family relationships, and his fantasies about being other people. Williams had to get inside his head and write music that was both psychologically nuanced and propelled the action of the film. The brilliance of the score reflects an eccentric, if creative, criminal mind and the tensions of a man constantly on the run. Frank's music is always conceiving a new scam, Williams notes. It's in his character, that little musical trigger that takes us off on a new escapade. In the published score for this movie, Williams wrote, "The film is set in the now nostalgically tinged 1960s, and so it seemed to me that I might evoke the atmosphere of that time by writing a sort of impressionistic memoir of the progressive jazz movement that was then so popular. The alto saxophone seemed the ideal vehicle for this expression." Well, we agree with that assessment, especially the part about the sax being the ideal instrument to express the film's musical theme. And what's more, we have an incredible sax soloist to perform this arrangement of Catch Me If You Can for you this afternoon. Now, following this selection, there's going to be a 15-minute intermission. But right now, ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome Phil Bossenberger. Thank you. That was a lot of fun. That opening selection was John Williams' Olympic fanfare and theme, and as you know by now, if you didn't before, Williams has written some of the best movie music hits that we've ever known. But for the Olympic Games in Los Angeles back in 1984, he opened a whole new genre of music, the brilliant fanfare theme. The huge sounds and lush textures that are so typical of Williams left a worldwide audience breathless when the composer premiered this exciting fanfare with the Los Angeles Symphony at the Olympic Games opening ceremonies. Now, Schindler's List is a 1993 American epic historical period drama. And again, it was directed and co-produced by Steven Spielberg. It's based on the novel Schindler's Ark by Thomas Canale, who was an Australian novelist. The film is based on the life of Oskar Schindler, an ethnic German businessman who saved the lives of more than 1,000 mostly Polish Jewish refugees during the Holocaust by employing them in his factories. John Williams, who, as I have mentioned a time or three, frequently collaborates with Spielberg, composed the exquisite musical score for Schindler's List, for which he won an unprecedented fifth Oscar in 1994. There's a story that tells of Williams reviewing the film's story with Spielberg, and the composer was just amazed by the film, and he thought maybe it would be too challenging, so Williams told Spielberg, "You need a better composer than I am for this film." To which Spielberg responded, "I know, but they're all dead." Well, for the music movie soundtrack, most of the selections were performed on the violin. But as you can see, with the exception of Roland back here, the band has no strings attached. However, much to the delight of wind bands everywhere, arranger Cal Custer has produced a beautiful version of the theme from Schindler's List with a flute as the solo instrument. And this afternoon, it is our pleasure to have our own wonderful flautist perform the theme. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome Carrie Smith.
Thank you.
usual, before we get to our final selection, we have a little business to take care of. First of all, on behalf of the entire band, I want to thank each and every one of you for coming out to spend some time with us this afternoon. We hope you've enjoyed this John Williams celebration. You know, I say this after every concert, but the message never changes. It's you, the audience, that makes these shows so much fun, and today, once again, we have had far more than our share. Those of us here on the stage are strictly here for the fun of it. We love to play, and having an appreciative audience as you have been today only adds to the enjoyment that we receive through this wonderful thing called music. Once again, thanks to Ken and Gina Peterson for sponsoring this performance. Special thanks are in order this afternoon to our flute ensemble for their part in today's concert. Thanks also to our soloists, Phil Bossenberger and Carrie Smith, for their fine performances. And last, but certainly not least, we can't forget to thank our ushers, our stage crew here at the center, and all those others who work behind the scenes, especially the great crew from MCTV for their fine work recording, producing, and broadcasting our performances. Finally, I would ask you to please mark your calendars for our next performance. It's going to be on the afternoon of Sunday, May 5th, 3 p.m., right here at the center, when we will be featuring our scholarship winners and our outstanding seventh graders. We hope you'll come and join us, and I'd encourage you to bring a friend. Now, in the early 1990s, composer John Williams was asked by his friend and colleague Steven Spielberg to compose the score for a new science fiction thriller, Jurassic Park. And it was based on the book by Michael Crichton. As you know, Jurassic Park tells the story of a theme park that suffers a major power breakdown during a preview tour, and it allows the cloned dinosaur exhibits to run amok. This 1993 film was Williams' 12th project with Spielberg, and it proved to be another cinematic success. Williams successfully created an atmosphere of amazement and underlying danger throughout the score, consistent with the wonder of seeing an island full of dinosaurs. In the masterful way that became Williams' trademark, he created sweeping themes to create an experience for moviegoers that drew them into the movie. From the wonder of the first dinosaur encounter to the terrifying chase scenes to the dramatic helicopter flyover rescue, Williams created a score that brought the story to life in magnificent ways. Well, our next selection is Jurassic Park soundtrack highlights, and it gives us a sample of that sweeping score. The arrangement we're playing is by Paul Lavender, and it includes many of the score's themes that you are going to instantly recognize. Once again, thank you and good afternoon.
Play and to listen to, and it's tough to get everyone's favorite on one concert, but if you have time for one more, we have a medley of a lot of our favorites all packed into one piece.
Thank you. Thank you.